Good evening and welcome. I am Crystal Sullivan, the Director of Campus Ministry here at the University of Dayton. I welcome you, those who are here present in the chapel, and those who are participating virtually, and thank you for choosing to attend tonight's remembrance. For those of you who are attending virtually, there is a program for the service tonight that is in the discussion or in the description of the event. Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass, is the name which describes the night of November 9, 1938, when a Nazi-inspired violent rampage in Germany and Austria destroyed Jewish businesses, synagogues, sacred books, and human lives. Kristallnacht is generally viewed as a critical step in the furthering of the Nazi policy that led to the Shoah, or Holocaust. Kristallnacht speaks to the critical importance of now. It recalls a time in history when there was still time to speak. A dark moment when many did not, for reasons we do not know, fear, apathy, lack of power, lack of awareness or the ability to connect the dots or the destruction happening around them. This remembrance is a summons for vigilance for the human family, especially in this particular moment in history, when anti-Semitism is on the rise, when efforts to be anti-racist are subverted, when immigrants and asylum seekers are ignored or criminalized, and when the COVID pandemic is shown to impact racially and ethnically minoritized communities at disproportionately destructive rates, and when political polarization is heightened. This is a moment when people of every race and creed can join together and say, never again, to anti-Semitism and to every form of destruction of human dignity. Most importantly, this is a moment to remember. The Holocaust was real. 6 million Jews and 1 million others lost their lives. Tonight, through our remembering, we ask God to summon us with courage to speak and to act, individually, collectively, and institutionally, that each human life may be radically valued in our world. Tonight, we prayerfully remember all who died at Kristallnacht and in the subsequent program of genocide, that their lives may never be forgotten. We begin our prayer with a moment of silence and lighting of candles in remembrance of them.
first reflective reading is from the testimony of Ina Rothschild. She was born in Darmstadt, Germany, in 1903, deported to Theresienstadt, liberated in 1945, emigrated to the United States in 1946. She and her husband ran a Jewish orphanage in Esslingen am Neckar, near Stuttgart, from 1933 to 1942, when they were sent to Theresienstadt. Suddenly, when we saw that they threw out of the office and out of our apartment and out of the synagogue everything, Sefer Torahs, books, the silver candelabras, and everything, and let it go up in flames, and here we were standing with the children in that rain, and the children cried in fear. And one of those monsters came over and said, if you are not quiet, we throw you in the flames too. And here we were standing until it was almost dark. Then they suddenly came and said, you can go into the house, what's left of it. The children were wet from up and from down. Nobody could go to a bathroom. And when we came in, there was no gas, no electricity, no water. Everything was turned off. And everything full of glass. The windows, the little synagogue, completely destroyed. We found there Samuel, one of the teachers, unconscious, beaten to a pulp. Second reflective testimony is from Willy Novak, born in Berlin, Germany in 1908. He was able to leave to go to Shanghai in 1939 and emigrated to the U.S. in 1948. When Kristallnacht came, from that moment on, it was impossible to work as a Jew. I was called in the morning by a German Christian friend who told me that I shouldn't go out on the street. I told him that I will because I want to see what's going on. So he went with me, and we were standing right on the other side of the street looking at the burning synagogue, at the prayer books laying on the street. The Torah scrolls laying on the street, burning. On both ends of the synagogue on the street were policemen standing and firemen. Nobody did anything to kill the fire. They just let it burn. They didn't do anything to save the synagogue or anything else. I listened to the comments, the laughter of the people among whom I was standing. I was very upset. My friend had to hold me back because I wanted to jump in and save at least the Torahs or a prayer book, anything. But he held me on both arms, trying to calm me down, not to start anything. Thank you.
ministry for inviting me here this evening to share in this remembrance of Kristallnacht. My name is Shelley Inglis, and I work as the Executive Director of the Human Rights Center here at the University of Dayton. I've spent most of my career working at the United Nations on the norms and institutions developed to address international law, including genocide, and I've worked in many conflict-affected societies. There's much I could say tonight about what has been done to prevent and respond to genocide since the Holocaust, and about the challenges we face today in this area. But this is 2020, and today I'm going to reflect on the meaning of Kristallnacht in our unique circumstances in America. We are experiencing this commemorative event for the first time amidst a global pandemic, which has killed over 230,000 Americans and over 1 million people worldwide. The numbers of infections recorded daily continue to reach all-time highs. Looking around this beautiful church this evening, there are few of us here in person. Normally, these pews would be filled with people of faith gathering to remember this evening. There is a sense of loss that permeates every dimension of American life today. The lives departed or destroyed, the businesses closed and jobs lost, the schoolyards abandoned. Losses felt most acutely by Black and Brown communities and working women with families. We've had wildfires causing losses of homes, farms, and breathable air, and the loss of many Black lives to police brutality has propelled tens of thousands of Americans to take to the streets and protest peacefully racial injustice. I've lived in countries where there is genocide. I arrived in Bosnia and Herzegovina in 1994 to central Bosnia, towns divided by war between Bosniak Muslims and Catholic Croats. Throughout my time in central Bosnia, as I traveled through these decimated villages and towns, each with its own particular front line, dividing the communities, usually a roadway width, with houses on each side completely destroyed, shot up, and abandoned. Though I had lived in Yugoslavia, the United country, and knew its complexity and its ethnic narratives, even so, I was at a loss. How can neighbors turn on each other like this? How does hate emerge so overwhelmingly and violently? Hannah Arendt, a German-born American Jew who survived the Holocaust as a refugee and became one of America's best-known but not uncontroversial political thinkers, explored the origins of totalitarianism. In her descriptions of the Nazi Adolf Eichmann during his trial in Israel for crimes against the Jewish people, she coined the phrase, the banality of evil. While Eichmann played a major role in the Holocaust, Arendt's insights help illuminate how ordinary people, without extraordinary malice, but with a strong need for group cohesion and a lack of critical thinking, can contribute to a broader system that results in mass atrocity. Of course, there are many factors grounded in specific contexts that make a society prone to conflict and mass atrocity. These include deep structural inequalities, grievance and victimization along ethnic, race, or religious lines, vested economic interests in retaining power, propaganda and disinformation, widespread availability of weapons, and a lack of accountability and independent institutions. But ordinary people play an indispensable role. When they lose empathy for others and can rationalize unacceptable actions of their self-identified group, creating a deep void of responsibility and accountability for those in power within their group. I've always believed the best prevention of conflict and mass atrocity is democratic societies, where the rule of law is respected, media is independent, power is held to account, and citizens have the fundamental rights required to act civically in public life. Today, as we know globally, these principles are under threat, including here in what is considered the world's most established and powerful democracy. Arendt was deeply concerned with the subjugation of political life to economics in our modern world. She surmised that political life is premised on individual agency, capacity for judgment, and the efficacy of our collective action. For Arendt, ordinary people cannot, in good conscience, avoid political life. The most effective politics is when citizens are capable to gather together to deliberate on decisions that affect their lives. Like so many of you, I've watched this past week, this election, with record-breaking turnout, despite the global pandemic and a climate of distrust. The electoral process has been smooth and peaceful. Thousands of people, beyond casting a vote, have contributed civically to our democracy, and young people have voted at record levels. We have heard experts explain what threats to democracy look like, and media widely report on these issues. Population has remained calm, and it appears that we have prevented a potential crisis in our democracy, at least as we gather here tonight. Though it is still uncertain, we may see a peaceful transfer of power, which is the golden standard and hallmark of a democratic society. It is a truism that our wealthiest democracies in which we live have been built on acts of mass atrocity. The spoils of oppressive systems, colonization, slavery, and Jim Crow, apartheid, bolstered by patriarchy and misogyny, undergird this wealth. And today it is our richest countries that are most responsible for the exploitation and consumption of the Earth's natural resources, threatening our shared environment and climate. This history remains potent to us in our institutions, the inequities in our domestic and global economy, and in our American way of life. While the U.S. is not completely exceptional in this regard, it is particular in America that every new generation, especially of white Americans, struggles anew with the contradiction between our exceptional group self-image and the real-life unjust outcomes of our systems. For Arendt, action is fundamental to the human condition. She prioritizes two forms of human action: unfixing the fixed past and fixing the unfixed future. For countries transitioning from conflict and mass atrocities, I have always promoted the high expectation that transformation requires the extremely difficult tasks of simultaneously reforming institutions, norms, and relationships while adequately atoning for both past and recent trauma and injustice. America of 2020, with its poverty, polarization, exhaustion, and inequities, demands that people of conscience act in this way. Educational institutions like the University of Dayton can contribute to building the individual agency, the capacity for critical thinking, and the judgment required of ordinary people to fulfill the responsibility of active citizenship in a democracy and avoid unthinking participation in grave injustice. In Arendt's view, the ultimate expression of human freedom is the ability to create something new in our political life. This is the type of freedom that we need most right now in the United States, throughout the world, and in our own community. Thank you.
as a people, we are called to act justly, to love with mercy, to walk with humility with God. I invite each of you to consider and seek out ways to take action for justice and change in faithful memory of those whose lives were lost at Kristallnacht and beyond. If you are at home, I invite you to take a moment to share that action that you might take in the chat on the YouTube channel, a way that you will take action for justice and change. If you are present here, I will invite you to light a candle as a sign of the witness for human dignity that you resolve to bring to your community. To offer a word of thanks to Shelley Inglis for her reflections for us today, and also Dr. Sharon Grotto and the World Music Choir, whose beautiful music we heard virtually instead of in person today, and for all those who had a hand in making that production happen. Let us pray. God of peace, we call upon your Spirit to breathe on this fractured world and heal the divisions that grow daily wider. Breathe on leaders that they might respect the right of all human beings to live in peace. Breathe on those who hate, opening the hand clenched in a fist that it might embrace. Breathe on the influential that their power might be used for the common good of all. Breathe on the individual and bring freedom from conflict and a life that's free from fear. God of peace, breathe on this fractured world and bring us hope. Let us go in peace. May you be blessed today and forever.